you very much for giving me this opportunity to say a few words on gratitude and thanks or generosity and gratitude. Actually, the Buddha said that there are two kinds of people which are very difficult to find. One who is generous and one who is thankful. So, on one side we are here, members of Buddhist Society of Victoria, on one side, and the donors on the other side. So when they come together, those two people, you know, those two groups, it's very rare. I didn't know exactly what the Buddha meant until when I was in Africa. And as a monk, I went for alms round to get my food, and people wanted to buy my alms bowl. So in many times I didn't get food actually. Yeah, luckily I had a backup, my mother. And my mother prepared me something. So in the beginning I didn't have a backup actually. So one time I came, there was no food, and I had to go without food. I remember that day. And another day I went, then people asked me, why are you begging money? Ugandan people are very poor. why are you begging food? They told me that it's not good to do this practice. But I explained them, they said, that's very good to do actually. So then somebody came up with potato chips, like maybe a countable ones, like a few of them, with omelette, and that was my lunch. So I know it's not so easy actually to give. Maybe there's a sense of attachment about things and a feeling that we are not going to have enough, right? So then we always hold on to things and then we don't give easily. But you have done such a wonderful work, practice to be generous and let go of your attachment, and also a practice that brings you happiness, because when you give, you get back happiness, definitely. Another practice also that I didn't know very much that's difficult is about gratitude. Until myself, I was practicing giving books to poor people, but also we got scholarship at the Uganda Buddhist Center to distribute to poor people. And then I could not give all this scholarship to all children because there's so many. So what I decided was to choose those who came frequently to the Dhamma school. Those who didn't come frequently, I decided to give them books. So the parents then came to me and asked, why did you give us books? Why didn't you give us scholarship? So instead of thanking first what they got, like at least they got books, they were just complaining why I didn't give them the scholarship. So that means also the practice of gratitude is not so easy, because it's very clear, you've got books, please thank me. Of course, I'm not looking for thanks, but still at least express gratitude that, okay, at least you have got some books. You don't have to buy books for the whole term, school term. So then I knew that actually this is not so easy to practice. So these are very profound practice, and we find them in some suttas like Mangala Sutta. The Buddha talks about being thankful as a blessing, and also being grateful as a blessing. So there's a Pali word katanyu and katavedi, usually they go together, but when they stand alone, still it means expression, right? Or expression of gratitude through words or through deeds. So either way, we are actually practicing gratitude. And then there's a good question. What did Buddha taught after his enlightenment? Most people cannot tell what the Buddha taught immediately after his enlightenment. when you look at clearly Buddha's life, what he taught after enlightenment is gratitude. After enlightenment, he spent like this in front of a tree looking at it, the Bodhi tree that he had given him shade. So that means the Buddha actually taught gratitude as soon as he enlightened. Of course, later on he went to give a talk on the Noble Eightfold Path, Dhamma Chakkappavattana Sutta, to the five ascetics. But we can clearly say that the first teaching the Buddha taught in action is gratitude. I mean, if he can be grateful for a tree, what about being grateful for the people who have donated money, donated material things? So this is very, very important to remember that this is, I believe, the first teaching the Buddha gave, gratitude. So now, since it's very difficult to find two people, one who's generous and one who's grateful, so then what should we do in our daily life? Is it one time giving and then we forget about it? No, it has to be in their life. In their life, we practice gratitude, being grateful of life itself. How many times you wake up in the morning and you say, oh, I'm very grateful to my life. I'm grateful to be alive. Not so many people wake up when they're alive. But we take it for granted that, okay, you should have a life. In fact, for me, I remember when I was staying in a monastery in West Virginia, I made it a practice that as soon as I wake up, before even I take a cup of tea, hot water, I would wake up and say, I'm grateful to be alive. I'm awake. And I would go out of my kuti and then I look at the trees like this. I'm so grateful to all the trees that are giving me oxygen. So the trees there are big lungs there. How often are we grateful to them giving us oxygen? I mean, to the Buddha, the tree was giving the shade. But trees are giving us oxygen every moment. You cut them out, and if you have all cars around the world and you don't have any single tree, you'll feel it. So we should be grateful to our life, actually, as a daily practice. And, of course, to all our relatives, all people, because other people, they are very meaningful to our life. Imagine the people like who keeps you alive, the food you eat, for instance. How many people are behind a morsel of food that you're eating? 1,000? 1,000,000? I think more than 1,000,000. So can we have a time and a chance to actually be grateful to all beings before we take our meal? All beings who are involved to growing food. For me, it's very clear when I travel in Asia, especially, because rice is so difficult to grow. Mm-hmm. I see people in the fields in Sri Lanka. When I'm on a train in Indonesia, it passes through these fields of rice, and I see the hard work that is involved to grow rice. But how often do we practice gratitude when we're eating it, as we're eating? Of course, not every muscle, oh, I'm grateful to people in Sri Lanka, I'm grateful to people in China. No. Just do it before you do a meal. I'm very grateful to all people who have grown this food. And that's it. That's quite enough, I think. Otherwise, if you keep on just saying these words, you miss to enjoy the meal, probably. So I think this is a very, very important practice, being grateful for your life itself, being alive. And your sense faculties are working very well. Grateful to your relatives, friends, and all beings. Imagine even the shirt you are putting on, the dress, all the clothes that you are putting on. How many people behind them? 1,000,000 people? More than that. What about the cushion you are sitting on? What about the building? What building? How many people behind this building? Can you guess? people started this monastery, this temple, this center. Many beings are behind it. Even a small place like Uganda Buddhist Temple, I just look at behind time when I started this center in 2005. I mean, even the first tent, it was given from Thailand. And then many things I've seen that have come together, many conditioners have come together. And for me, I can see now it's 11 years, it's more than a billion people behind that. So now the monastery at Newbury Monastery, Buddhist Monastery, it has many people behind, and you are part of them. So the key is to keep the practice going, the practice of generosity and the practice of gratitude. How can we keep the practice of generosity going? Of course, you may not be able to give every day $100, but if you can't do that, you may not be able to give monthly, maybe you are giving yearly, it's up to you, but still, can we put the practice of generosity in our daily life, right? It's very, very important. The Buddha talked about different kind of generosity, but before I became a Buddhist, I didn't know actually about this kind of generosity. One of them is, of course, material generosity, giving things. And that's what I knew all the time until I became a Buddhist, that there's even more than that, other than giving material things. The Buddha talks about abhayadana, abhaya, like fearless, right? Giving fearlessness. And this is can be practiced through the practice of the five precepts at the minimum. In Anguttara Nikaya, the Buddha talks about somebody who practices the five precepts, gives what we call Mahadana, the great generosity. And that's the generosity of giving fearlessness to all beings. To all beings. In other words, you give freedom from danger. So people around you, they don't have to be afraid. They don't have to be afraid because this gift of fearlessness is the one which you're giving to them. I can build all monasteries around the world, but I cannot give this gift of fearlessness to all beings. You see? It's very powerful. Just being in a place here like in Australia and you keep the five precepts, it's already a gift to yourself and to all beings, not only human beings, but all beings around the world. So we can do that, upholding the five precepts, giving fearlessness, giving freedom from fear, freedom from danger. That's another generosity we can practice in our daily life. But maintaining more of the positive side, positive part of those precepts, having loving kindness and compassion, giving, of course, being contented, and giving respect in relationships, giving respect also to the truth, being honest, and also being diligent in your practice of generosity and other practices. So this is very, very important to maintain their life, and that's what is going to provide condition for giving to support the temple, because you're already practicing it. You're already practicing it in their life. And then there's other kind of generosity, of course, giving energy. Giving energy is also very important practice of generosity, because most people might just give material things, but when you tell them, oh, come to Newbury Monastery to volunteer, they say, no, I don't have time. I don't have time. There's time to do something else, time to do other things, but there's no time to come to volunteer. giving time, of course, means to give time to those who need it. It's also that's part of generosity. Most people say they don't have time. But when you look at it clearly, they have time. The only thing that they have is not priorities. Right? They have time, but they don't have priorities. But then the question is, why people find it difficult to give time and give energy? We have to ask this question. Why people find it difficult to give energy? Come to volunteer at Uganda Buddhist Center. Oh, no, I have no time. Let's go for a wedding. Uncle Sam is marrying somebody. There is time for that. Playing football, there's time for that. Playing, I don't know the Australian game here, but there must be some time for something except volunteering at a center. We need painting. Oh, no, I don't have time. We need no time. Actually, when you look at it, in our daily life, we tend to infuse a sense of self, first in the material things, and then in our energy and time, because this is close to our ego. Time is so close to our ego. And energy is so close to our ego. So giving it up, it's like giving up your ego, basically, kind of smashing it. Of course, also giving material things has become difficult because also there's a sense of self smuggled into our objects, whether it's money or something. So we infuse a sense of self in our material things also. But with time and energy, it's so close to us. Because since we are born, we have time to play with our dolls, we have time to play with our toys, we have family time, we have all this time divided into different slots. Time to take shower, time to eat, time to do this. So now if I say, give me that part of time where you have to do something else apart from the normal thing you do. No, it's my sense of self. I hold on to it. So that's why it's so difficult. So you people are supporting here. Of course, you can support in material things and giving energy, giving time. So many kinds of support, actually, many times of practice, many ways of practicing generosity. But most people think it's only going to be only material things. But it's not only material things. Look at it this way. If somebody came to volunteer here, and the money you would pay for somebody to work for 1 year, can you value that money? Let's say if you get a volunteer here for 1 year. The good thing actually, you alternate here. I think you don't feel it. But in Uganda, I haven't done that roster. It's very good, actually. But in whatever way you look at it, volunteers who come here, if you put that into money, there will be a lot of money paying for salary somebody to work here. Yeah, so even somebody who come to volunteer is already practicing a lot of generosity in one way or the other. So we encourage you to have people to continue with your generosity in terms of material things, in terms of your time, in terms of your energy. And finally, if you cannot donate material things, time and energy, what are you going to donate? What? Donate your practice. I think your practice, if you keep practicing Buddha's teaching, that's your generosity in general. Because for me, most people think, in Uganda they say, Venerable, we don't have time. But they say, I have to take my kid to play football. So always Buddhist practices is given the last chance, you know. Why didn't you come to listen to Dhamma talk? Oh, you know, I was doing this and this. There's always an excuse. There's always an excuse. For us, as monastics, we don't have much to give. But the Buddha told us that the biggest generosity is Dhamma. In Dhamma, you give a gift to life. Because when people listen to Dhamma, it's like medicine and they can heal. So we monastics, we also practice generosity. The center practices generosity, like bring teachers here and distribute Dhamma, and talks and all that. So this is a kind of thing that we are doing all together, generosity and grateful. So in other words, we are returning your generosity by being very grateful, by making the Dhamma practice available here at the center for all people to come. Even me from Uganda, I come here. It's such a wonderful place in order to express my gratitude and also to be generous. Thank you very much for listening. I hope this is something that you can reflect on. All what I'm doing, actually, I'm offering this for your reflection, that let us continue to practice generosity and gratitude. Thank you very much for listening. Time's up. Time for question and answer session. And you can ask anybody. You can ask a question, and for us, we are going to answer them randomly. Whatever question you have about generosity and gratitude, because we want to keep with the theme. But if you don't have questions around that theme, you can ask about any other question. Let me answer that one, because I've just given a talk recently in a family. I told that family to be very practical, very, very practical. What you would do in your family, you hold a hand like this, all together, children, because, you know, children, they don't want abstract things. Like now I can give a talk like this, but if I'm going to talk with children, it will be the same talk but different. Children need something to touch, right? They need something to touch, and they need to be face-to-face, right? And they need to be probably even around like this. Get them in a circle because they'll be seeing each other, and then you hold all together like this. And then you can start teaching them to be grateful to mom. So, and also, first you first express your gratitude to the child. I like you, Ananda. I'm giving an example. If the kid is called Ananda, Ananda, I like the way you go to school. I like the way you brush your teeth. I like the way you keep your books together. So you start being like that, teaching by doing. First, you have to do it. Don't ask Ananda first. You have to teach that kid by expressing your gratitude to that kid. This is not the time to mention, oh, but actually you didn't clean your bed. No. This is the time actually only to focus on good things. And then you go around like this. Then you ask also, be grateful to mom. Okay, I'd like you to repeat. Ananda, repeat. Be grateful to mom because she prepared a good meal for you. And then, so it has to be a daily practice, maybe before a meal, like that. So make it a ritual in your home. Yeah, so because kids now are so busy with gadgets and all the things, and then it will be very difficult to hold their attention. But around a meal, it's very easy because they are ready. And then before taking the meal, then you do that. Or before they go to sleep, whatever time you can choose, but for mealtime, I think is the best. Because I remember when I was growing up, because our family is a Christian family, so that a meal is what brought us together, right? So, and then you express gratitude. So in fact, we should do it every day to make sure that we express gratitude every day. Or write a note to them if they are not at your home. Write them a note. When they come to school, let them find a note. I'm grateful to Elizabeth. Your kid that says Elizabeth. I'm grateful to Elizabeth for being available. For being available when I need you. So most people actually, this is what I found out, when people live in a family, they just focus only the wrong things people do. Oh, Elizabeth, you didn't do this, you didn't do this. But people don't mention what people do. This also comes in a meditation center when there's a retreat. Don't do this, don't pass here, don't do this, don't do this. You're not allowed to pass here, you're not allowed to sit like this. So then people ask us, what should we do? And then we come to the precept, abstain from killing, abstain from taking what's not given, abstain from this and that and that. So what can we do? People don't tell people what to do. This is unfortunate. So now this is a practice that you have to put in every day. Then kids are going to learn because you taught them. And it's on a daily basis. It is going to be ingrained in them. So I'm going to assure you that kids will learn if you make it enjoyable. If you make it enjoyable, and if you get visitors, kids visiting, you can, before then you're giving them a meal, let them join you. Irrespective of their religion, every religion have the practice of generosity and gratitude. So before you go for a meal, put all the people together with the kids and everybody, and you share what you like about the other person, right? And then also they share. It's a two-way street. What if you don't have anything to be grateful for that person? What are you going to say? Be grateful for their presence. Yeah, I'm very grateful that you are present here. Most people don't know that presence is also part of a gift.